enough enjoying each other's company.
Let there be peace. Let there.
You want to just?
We're going to switch
To tomorrow night.
To tomorrow night. And
Monday night.
Tuesday
at 6 o'clock.
Tuesday night is New Year's Eve.
That makes sense. Okay. So for those of you who were following that conversation, we're switching the undecorating of the church to tomorrow night. That's Monday at 6 o'clock because apparently Tuesday is New Year's Eve. Apparently people want to celebrate, and they don't want to celebrate with each other here. They'd like to do that somewhere else. So for those of you who were planning on coming on Tuesday, just plan on coming on Monday, and then you can be all alone on Tuesday night at your house. For the rest of you, I'm thankful that you're here this morning. As I mentioned earlier, my name is Zach. I'm the pastoral assistant. Pastor Gary, who would normally be here, and Ken Brothers, who is one of our elders here, they decided to take a trip to Albuquerque. I don't know why anyone wants to go to Albuquerque, but they wanted to go to visit some folks who they're celebrating their 50th anniversary, I believe, and they used to be members here. So they're away. And basically, Pastor Gary said, you know, not that many people come this Sunday after Christmas because people are away. And so he said, I'm sure you can handle it. And worst case scenario, there's not that many people there anyway, so it's not going to be that memorable. So you'll be fine. So he said, I could run the show this Sunday while he was away. Listen, that's not in my budget. That's Pastor Gary's budget, and I don't have his credit card, so. Perfect second service, pizza on bill. So if you've been following along with us this Christmas season, we have been doing a series on carols. And so this morning we'll wrap that series up with We Three Kings, and you'll hear a little bit more why, you know, we're continuing this carols after Christmas. It's kind of odd. Most churches would move on, but with We Three Kings, there's actually a legitimate reason for us to talk this morning about carols still. So hopefully you had a nice Christmas this past week, and hopefully you're happy to be here with us this morning, because we're definitely happy to have you. I'm curious, how many of you are familiar with We Three Kings, the carol? Yes? Okay, good. So hopefully this morning I have something new for you, because I know that this is a relatively familiar carol. So the history of the song, I'm not sure many of you would know that. In 1857, by John Henry Hopkins Jr. was the gentleman who originally wrote We Three Kings. He was an Episcopal priest from Pittsburgh, so good old Pennsylvania, yeah. So we're glad that he's our brethren in Pennsylvania. And the song was actually originally meant for a Christmas pageant for New York City. So he was writing it to be performed in New York City. And it was intended for three male voices to represent the three magi. And so they would have their piece. Yeah, the three gifts. Well, we'll get there. But if you want to preach, you're welcome to come up here, because you're stealing my thunder this morning. No, I appreciate it. Yes, we will get there. So the song is actually also considered one of the first U.S. Christmas carols to achieve international popularity. So that's something I didn't know. I was researching it, but that's their claim to fame, was one of our first songs to catch on outside of our own country. As far as Christmas carols go. So we're going to take a look at the song this morning together. So I'll read for you. You also have on your insert, you have the lyrics on the back, so you can follow along there. And theoretically, they're also on slides. So I underdid it the last time that I preached, and I neglected to put things in the slides. So this time I'm overdoing it and making sure you can definitely follow along with me. So let's look at the lyrics together this morning. We three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts we traverse afar, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. O star of wonder, star of light, star with royal beauty bright, westward leading, still proceeding, guide us to thy perfect light. Born a king on Bethlehem's plain, Gold I bring to crown him again, King forever, ceasing never, over us all to reign. Frankincense to offer have I, incense owns a deity nigh, prayer and praising, voices raising, worshiping God on high. Myrrh is mine, its bitter perfume breathes a life of gathering gloom, sorrowing, sighing, bleeding, dying, sealed in this stone-cold tomb. Glorious now, behold him arise, King and God in sacrifice. Alleluia, alleluia, sounds through the earth and skies. So this song is actually, it's a beautiful retelling of the biblical account of Jesus' birth in Matthew 2. And this morning I'd like to focus more on the story behind the song and look into kind of the history and some of the background of that story. It's a story of three kings following a star to worship a new king. So let's pray together, and then we'll turn together to the scripture. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to worship you. We thank you for music and what it does to our soul when we get to sing praises to you, when we get to worship you in music. And we thank you for those who you've gifted with the ability to write and produce music. And we thank you for songs like this that point us to your scripture and point us to your narrative of redemption, Lord. And we pray that this morning you would prepare our hearts to hear what you have to say through this song, through your scripture, and through your story that you've given us. We pray these things in your son's name. Amen. So let's turn together to Matthew 2 and bear with me. I will read for you, because we all like a good story. I will read for you the scripture, but you can follow along on the slides or in the Bibles in your pews. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod, this is on a slide, guys, just so you know. The king, Magi from the east, arrived in Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him, gathering together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for this is what has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the leaders of Judah, for out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called the Magi and determined from them the exact time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. And when you have found him, report to me, so that I too may come and worship him." After hearing the king, they went their way, and the star, which they had seen in the east, went on before them until it came and stood over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell to the ground and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they presented to him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, the Magi left for their own country by another way. Now when they had gone, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to destroy him." So Joseph got up and took the child and his mother while it was still night and left for Egypt. He remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then when Herod saw that he had been tricked by the Magi, he became enraged and sent and slew all the male children who were in Bethlehem and all its vicinity, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had determined from the Magi. Then what had been spoken through Jeremiah the prophet was fulfilled. "A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and she refused to be comforted because they were no more. But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, 'Get up, take the child and his mother, and go into the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead.' So Joseph got up, took the child and his mother, and came into the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. Then after being warned by God in a dream, he left for the regions of Galilee and came and lived in a city called Nazareth. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophets. He shall be called a Nazarene. So when we read through this scripture and through the song, it kind of raises a few questions for me. So that's where we're going to focus this morning, are on these questions that it raises for me. So the first question is this: what's up with the Magi? Okay? That's my first question. What's up with the Magi? The second question is, what got Herod so worked up? And the third question is this: why does it matter for us? Okay, so I think we'll try to keep it simple this morning. Some of us are still comatose from our Christmas meals, and so we'll keep it simple, those three questions. What's up with the Magi? What got Herod so worked up? And why does it matter? So what's up with the Magi? My question is, who are we talking about here? Because in the song, it mentions kings, right? In the scripture, it mentions Magi. Sometimes we tell the story, we say wise men. Who were these people? So the biblical account starts with Magi. So that's where we're going to focus. We're going to call them Magi for now. Historical accounts say that Magi were actually originally a Median tribe of priests. So that's to say that they were from Media, which was in Persia, not that they were like an average tribe of priests, Median. They were from Media in Persia. The tribe is noted to have had great political power, actually not just in Media, but also in Babylonian kingdoms, Persian kingdoms, and Parthian kingdoms as well. So I also want to be clear that they were not Jews, right? They actually were Gentiles, and their religion focused mostly on natural elements and natural world. If anyone's watched the Avatar, the airbender Avatar, it's kind of like that, where they focus on earth, wind, fire, water, things like that. And so that was their religion was focused on. And then actually Zoroastrianism, if anyone is familiar with Zoroastrianism, it evolved out of that, because Zoroastrianism focused on fire, and they worshiped fire. And so their religion evolved out of the Magi's religion of focusing on these natural elements in the earth. Another significant emphasis for Magi was astronomy, and that's why we find them searching the stars, right? So they're looking at the stars, studying the stars, and that's why we find them noticing the star that showed and revealed Christ's birth. So there's actually also a number of inconsistencies about the number of visitors, which you brought up, right? So we traditionally say that there's three. Early traditions actually said that there were 12 Magi, but the scripture actually doesn't say what number. Over time, general consensus set the number at 3, but most likely that was just because there were 3 gifts, right? And so because there were 3 gifts, we assume there are 3 Magi, and that's kind of what led to that assumption. And then over time, the three wise men, or Magi, or kings, whatever we're calling them, they were actually given names. Does anyone know the names that were given to the three wise men? Anyone? No? Yeah, Benny, Mac, and no. So the names that were given to them were Melchior, Caspar, and Balthazar. Anyone? That rings a bell? Yeah? Okay. It didn't for me, but I'm glad that you guys are well ahead of me, because I had to research this. I didn't know Melchior, Caspar, and Balthazar. And the reason why I didn't know that was because it's not a normal part of our tradition. But in other Christian traditions, it is more normal for them. There's an article that I found written by William Saunders, who is from the Catholic Education Resource Center, and he described them this way. Since the 7th century, in the Western Church, the Magi have been identified as Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. A work called the Excerpta et Collectanea, which was attributed to St. Bede in 735 AD, wrote, "The Magi were the ones who gave gifts to the Lord. The first is said to have been Melchior, an old man with white hair and a long beard, who offered gold to the Lord as to a king. The second, Caspar by name, young and beardless and ruddy complexioned, honored him as God by his gift of incense, an oblation worthy of divinity. The third, black-skinned and heavily bearded, named Balthazar, by his gift of myrrh, testified to the Son of Man who was to die." So as the tradition evolved, it was said that each of these wise men actually came from different places. Caspar was king of Tarsus, and was about 20 years old. Balthasar was king of Ethiopia and was about 40 years old, and Melchior was king of Arabia and was in his 60s. And this became a symbolic representation of how diverse the followers of Jesus were. And I actually have a picture we could probably put up here, maybe, possibly, on one of these slides. There it is. Okay. So this is called The Adoration of the Kings by Gerard David, and it shows, if you look, the one in the red on his knees is Melchior, and so he was the one that was in his 60s, and he brought gold, and he was supposedly a king from Arabia. And then the one in the middle, right, that was Caspar, who was the one that was the youngest in his 20s from Tarsus, and he brought frankincense. And then Balthasar was the one all the way to the right who brought myrrh and was apparently from Ethiopia and was in his 40s. So that's the legend or the tradition that has evolved. And that's mostly in the Western and in the Orthodox cultures and in the Roman Catholic cultures that people would be more aware of this side to the story. There's also thought to be some symbolism behind the gifts that were given, right? And it was kind of briefly mentioned in that article that I read. Aside from the fact that these gifts were very expensive and implied a significant level of honor and status, the gifts are also said to have brought this kind of spiritual symbolism into the story. And it's kind of debatable whether or not those, the magi that brought the gifts and the people at the time would have understood or thought of it this way. It may have been something that kind of evolved over time in our tradition. But it is said that the gold represents Christ's kingship or royalty. The frankincense symbolizes his priestly role. And the myrrh was often used in embalming, and so they say that it was pointing to the fact that Jesus was to die for our sins, and that he would be buried. And so these are the kind of three symbols that they say come along with these gifts. Additionally, the gifts would have been a significant financial resource, and so for Jesus's family and also for his ministry, it's possible, some scholars say, that it would have funded his entire ministry until his death. That's how much these were worth. Again, debatable whether or not that's what they used it for, but it's something that scholars kind of talk through as part of the tradition. As the traditions evolved around these three visitors, they eventually actually got their own holiday. Does anyone know the name of the holiday? And this is kind of a trick question, because there's what? Three Kings Day. That's one of the answers. Yes, so there's a few answers. What? Yes, yeah. So there's actually a few names. Three Kings Day, Theophany, or Epiphany are all acceptable answers. There are actually more than that, but they're in Spanish, and I don't speak Spanish, so we'll have to get someone next service who speaks Spanish to tell me the other names. So does anyone actually know the dates that these are celebrated? Another trick question, because they're celebrated on two different days depending on your tradition. Anyone? Yes. Oh, it's on there? Oh, dang. My wife's a teacher. She's going to have to reprimand me later for being a bad teacher. I put the answers on the worksheet. Yeah, no, it's on my worksheet I gave him. Anyway, so yes, the 6th or the 19th. And it's interesting. I didn't realize this, but that's where we get the idea of the 12 days of Christmas from, because originally, the 12 days of Christmas started on the 25th and ended on the 6th. So you get 12 days of Christmas. What our commercialized Christmas has done is they flip-flop it, so you have 12 days of Christmas before Christmas, and that's your rush to go buy presents and whatnot. But originally it was that the 12 days of Christmas started on the 25th and ended on the 12th. I'm curious, has anyone ever celebrated this holiday? Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah, absolutely. So I'm glad that you're here, because I was actually talking with our tech guys, and I was like, I'm going to ask this question, but I'm not sure if anyone's going to know. but I'm glad that you're here. So I'm going to share a little bit more about some of the different traditions, because as you kind of look into this, you'll find that throughout the world, it's celebrated very differently. So people here celebrate it a certain way, but in different parts of the world, you'll see it's celebrated very differently. So I have two clips for us. If you guys can pull up the first one and then roll right into the second one, we'll watch a little bit about the holiday.
All right, now today, Christians all over the world are celebrating Epiphany, or Three Kings Day. It's a celebration found in the Bible's Gospel of Matthew that describes the revelations of Christ as God. So for viewers that are unfamiliar with this holiday, we have HuffPost Senior Religion Editor, Reverend Paul Rauschenbusch, here to explain to us what it is all about. Reverend, thanks for being here.
And, happy Epiphany.
So what is the Epiphany?
Epiphany is, it's basically the revelation of Jesus as God, a Christian celebrated around the world. It's celebrated differently. Western Christianity tends to celebrate it as the event when the three magi come and they're looking for Jesus. They find Jesus. They venerate Jesus. And that's the way they identify him as the Messiah. The Eastern Orthodox tradition actually associates this holiday with the baptism of Jesus in the River Jordan. The dove comes down. A voice from the heaven says, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased." So they call it Theophany. And what's interesting is they have different ways of celebrating. So in the Western, you see in like Spain and even here in New York, we had camels in Brooklyn today where they celebrate and they have, you know, people as the wise men coming. Uh-huh. And it's a big day of giving gifts. Tres Reyes, Three Kings Day, that's a big celebration in the West. In the Eastern, it's almost cooler, because what they do is they throw a cross into these freezing rivers in like Bulgaria and in Greece, and they go dive for it. So it's a different kind of celebration. Both are major feast days for Christianity. It's a big holiday.
All right, one more. Maybe. I rolled out a challenge for them this morning. No?
Three Kings Day is really special for me. For Puerto Rican kids who grew up in New York, it's like this extra holiday. I don't know how aware you are of this tradition, but this is the way we celebrate it as a family. The day before, on January 5th, I'd go out to the park near my house with my dad, and we would go collect grass and hay for the camels of the Three Kings. You get enough to fill a shoebox, and you put it next to your bed. Just like you would leave milk and cookies for Santa, we're leaving grass and hay for the camels to eat, because they've obviously come a very long way. They're coming to Upper Manhattan to bring you toys. And you go to sleep, and you wake up, and there's presents at the foot of your bed. Second of all, there's grass and hay all over your house. So your brain is filled with the mental images of, oh my goodness, there were camels in my house. And they traipsed up the stairs, and they ate the hay next to my bed. And it's this incredible Three Kings Day miracle. Now here's the thing. If you're growing up in New York, you gotta go to school that day. But you get to go to school with your new toys. I went to a school
you
with
can
not
cut
a
it
lot
now.
Of...
He goes on to talk about a foundation that he had that year, and he was raising money to give presents, but that was last year, so it's not happening anymore. So we just wanted to hear his story. And there are so many different stories about how different people across the world celebrate this holiday. And in a lot of ways, I really love that it happens that way for them, because it almost extends Christmas, right? It's kind of like what you're talking about. For us, in our tradition, typically it's like, okay, we work up to Christmas, Christmas happens, and then it's like, okay, clean out the church, right, and move on. But for these traditions, Christmas starts the celebration, but then they really continue to celebrate, and there's feasts, and there's parties, and there's just this longer celebration venerating Christ. And as they mentioned too, some of their feasts and festivals, it actually points to different parts of Christ's ministry and his life that oftentimes we just kind of look at, okay, he came, he was incarnate, and then, well, he died on the cross for us, so that's a big part of it too. But they look throughout and they celebrate his whole life and his whole ministry, which is just kind of a really neat thing that we don't get to experience typically in our culture. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. 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 Yeah, exactly. So, and I love a party. So the more parties that we can have celebrating Jesus, why not, right? So just very interesting. But as we look at this, I do want to point out that there kind of continues to be some inconsistencies, some things that we're not sure about, some things that throughout these different cultures, they celebrate differently, they talk about it differently. So one of those things is this idea of three kings, 12 wise men, how many, what were they? And so I want to focus a little bit more on kind of the kings versus the magi, who were they? So let's look briefly into why in our culture and in our history we've started calling them kings, right? So just curious, does anyone have a guess as to why traditionally we started incorporating the term kings for the magi? Anyone? Oh, bummer. So it's in Old Testament prophecies that point to Christ's coming. It appears to be pointing to this, the visit of the magi, and kind of referring to them as kings in Old Testament prophecies. And so I want to look at one together, because we don't have time to look at all of them, but we'll look at one together this morning in Isaiah 60, verses 1 to 6. And again, you can follow along on the screens, you could look it up in the Bible, or you could just listen to my voice as I read it. It says, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. For behold, darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness the peoples. But the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory will appear upon you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes round about and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons will come from afar, and your daughters will be carried in the arms. Then you will see and be radiant, and your heart will thrill and rejoice, because the abundance of the sea will be turned to you. The wealth of the nations will come to you. A multitude of camels will cover you. The young camels of Midian and Ephah, all these from Sheba, will come. They will bring gold and frankincense and will bear good news of the praises of the Lord." So do you hear in this prophecy some of the correlation with the story of Jesus' birth? It kind of presents this conflict, right? Because in this prophecy, they're referred to as kings, but in the story of Jesus' birth, they're referred to as magi. And, you know, so the question is, what were they? So they look at this prophecy over time, and people began to argue that because of the prophecy, the magi must have actually been kings. Interestingly enough, though, when the arguments were being kind of considered, magi actually had become political leaders and kings. They became royalty at that time. But unfortunately, that was not until the 6th century. So that was many, many years after Christ's birth. And so I think that probably influenced the argument, because they were saying, well, the magi are kings. And so, you know, the prophecy said they were kings. The magi are kings. So they must have been kings. But unfortunately, what kind of has happened is, or at least what we've become aware of, is that in history, the Magi were not kings at that time. So some commentators tend to think that the prophecy in Isaiah 60 and others were kind of intended to be fulfilled throughout time. And so it wasn't that that one prophecy was speaking about one particular time, but that the prophecy spans history. And it really is pointing to a lot of different times throughout history where God is fulfilling his prophecy and where God is fulfilling his commitment and his covenant to his people. And I tend to lean towards that interpretation, because I think that it fits better with history. When we look at history, we don't want to distort history to try to fit a prophecy. We want to look at the prophecy and say, how did this prophecy come about and be fulfilled in history? So the next thing that I want to look at with you is the story of King Herod. Has anyone ever, like, wondered why King Herod freaked out the way that he did? Anyone? No. Good. So that's what we're going to wonder this morning. Let's wonder together. Why did King Herod get so worked up? What got him so worked up? So the Magi, as we kind of mentioned, the Magi were these Persian religious and political advisors at the time. And part of their duties actually included electing new kings. And so because they were political advisors, a lot of the times nations would call upon the Magi to help them pick the next king. And so also Persia and Israel, they had kind of been trampled by Rome, right? If we remember our history, hopefully I was talking to Rebecca. I was like, I hope there's no like real history buffs here because my history is rough. But what had happened was Persia and Israel had been conquered by Rome, and they were kind of starting to gain independence. And Herod, if we noticed in the story when we read earlier in the scripture, Herod died, right? So Herod was actually ill at the time. And it said that he had been overcoming bouts of illness, and eventually it led to his death, which is why then Jesus and Joseph and Mary were able to come back into the Holy Land, because he died. So we see that Herod is hearing this news of these Magi coming to look for a new king in Israel at a time where he is ill, and also we know that Augustus was also, he was getting up there in years, and so their region politically was kind of weak, and so he's seeing this as, is Persia trying to make an alliance with Israel, right, where these Persian priests are coming to anoint a new king? Are they allying themselves against us at a time where I might die and Augustus might die at any time? Are they trying to take their land back? So that's the way he's seeing it. And, you know, I'd never really thought about it that way. And that's what's kind of fun about studying scripture and then thinking through the history and all this stuff. I kind of geek out about it because it's really interesting to think through politically, why was this stuff happening? And so Herod ultimately committed infanticide because he was concerned that a new king was going to arise and that this allegiance was going to come about. And my last question that we're going to kind of look at this morning is, why does it matter for us? 2,000 years later, why does it matter? I understand that, you know, it's interesting to talk through the history, but, you know, it happened, right? And this story of these Magi, it must have some importance for us because we see, obviously, there are entire holidays and celebrations and there's songs and there's all of this talk about the Magi. And so it must matter for us. And the thing that I've kind of come to conclude is that there's a few things, right? The Magi, they were the first Gentiles that were recognizing Christ and worshiping him. That's big news, right? If we think about Israel and their interaction with Gentiles, there were some Gentiles that became Jews and they had a relationship with the Lord, but this is a big turning point because now we have Gentiles who've recognized that Jesus is a Lord, he's a king, and they came to worship him. It's incredible because it actually is the start of a mass increase in Gentiles having the opportunity to have a relationship with the Lord. So it's a big deal that these Gentile priests were coming to worship the Lord. And I also think that the Magi, they left a great example for us. The Magi were not Jews, but they saw a sign from the Lord and they were willing to follow it, right? And you have to think, like, put yourself in their shoes. They're religious leaders for an entirely different religion and they see a sign from the Lord and they're willing to follow it. That's a lot of open-mindedness, right? And willingness to follow the Lord. And even if you don't believe, my question for you is, are you open to God? Because, I mean, that's the story that I see in the Magi. They didn't believe in Yahweh, the God of Israel, and yet they were open to him. Like the Magi, are you open enough to see God working and then respond to it, which is exactly what they did. And then in the story, to contrast the Magi, we have Herod, who's so concerned with himself and maintaining his power and lifestyle that he became angry and afraid of Jesus, and he lashed out in his anger. And I'm not saying that everyone who is, you know, trying to protect themselves from God is going to go and commit infanticide, but what I am saying is that his closed-mindedness is what led to his anger. And my question for you this morning is this: are you a Herod or are you a Magi? I think that's really the meaning of the story. Obviously it happened, but then for us 2,000 years later, we can look on this and we can go, are we more like Herod or are we more like the Magi? I'm sure that many of you here today do believe in Jesus, and you do recognize him as your Savior, and obviously that's great, but I still think that for us who do recognize Jesus as our Savior, we still have this question that's pertinent to us, is are we like a Herod or are we like a Magi? I'm always so sad when I meet Christians that look more like a Herod than like a Magi, right? And I think many of us in this room can say that that's happened to us. We've met people and we're surprised that they say that they go to such and such a church, or they're a part of, they're an elder, or they're this or that, because sometimes we meet other people who are Gentiles, like the Magi were, and they're more open-minded, and they're more kind, and they're more willing to respond to what the Lord is doing. So I would urge you this morning to consider the Magi, and to consider the humble spirit, and to be open to see what God might be doing in your life. And that might mean that he's making changes to your lifestyle. And trust me, just as we see in the story of Jesus, God's plan, it does ultimately work out in our favor in the long run. But sometimes it's hard, and I think that, again, in the contrast, that's what was happening with Herod. He saw his lifestyle and what God was doing, and he was afraid. And so for us this morning, as we close out this year, I want to give you the opportunity to consider what resolutions you might make, right? New Year's resolutions. This is a time where so often we talk about getting healthy or spending less money or treating people better. And I would say maybe consider how you might be less of a Herod and more of a Magi this year. And I've left a space for you in your notes for you to write down a resolution. And I challenge you either now or later to kind of pray through, how am I like a Herod and how could I be more like a Magi? Now, writing it down is only the first step. I find that the best way for me to keep commitments is to tell someone else. And oftentimes when I'm making commitments with myself and I'm not really honest about doing it, I just don't tell anyone because it's like, I don't really want to do that. So like, I'm gonna exercise, but I'm not gonna tell anyone. Like, I'm not gonna ask Rebecca to wake me up at 6 o'clock to exercise. I could do that and she would do it, but then I'd probably not be happy about it. And so I really never intended to fulfill that commitment in the first place. So I would challenge you next to think through who could hold you accountable to that decision. And I left a space for you to write that person's name as well. And I know for many of us, it's really hard to make a commitment, and then it's really hard to talk to others about these commitments, because really what we're doing is we're recognizing our weaknesses and we're letting someone into the fact that, hey, I have this weakness and I want to work on it. And that's a hard thing to do. But I would challenge you because some of the best times in my life and also some of the best times in my relationships have come after sharing that type of thing with someone, my weakness and asking someone to help me. And so I hope that as we kind of close out the year, that this would be a blessing to you, that you would consider, how am I like a Herod and how can I be more like a Magi? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the story of the Magi. We thank you for these other traditions that celebrate in different ways, Lord. We thank you for all the wisdom that we can see and learn and glean from these stories, from these traditions, from these other Christians around the world who celebrate you in such awesome and wonderful ways. Lord, I pray that this, as the year ends and as our holiday season for some of us ends, I pray that you would help us to see just how good you are. Help us to see what you're doing in our lives. Help us to see how we are maybe like a Herod and how we could be more like a Magi. And I pray, Lord, that you would put someone in our life that would help us to work on those things. Obviously, you've given us the Holy Spirit, Lord, and we're so thankful for that. But it's also helpful for us to have a friendly reminder from a friend or a loved one. And I pray, Lord, that you would use those times, use those conversations about growth and our weaknesses to help us to become more like you, to be more like Christ, and ultimately to be a light for you. And we pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.